All right, here we go. You guys ready? Thank you for choosing this classroom. I know there was hard choices to make on where you were gonna spend the next hour and a half. So thank you guys for coming in here. First off, I don't have a microphone right now because I had the choice between the Britney Spears microphone or the handheld, so I'm waiting on the handheld just because. I know, but it's, they gave me this short guy. So unless you want to see me just stand right here the entire time, it's okay. It's okay. So I want to start off real quick. And how many people have had a class with me before? All right. Making my way around the world. That's good. All right, so that's good. It's not going to take as much to impress you guys. It's just the first time. Today we're going to discuss salon business, but in a modern way. I'm very anti-old school ways. So if you're set in your ways, this is not the right place for you. If you're open-minded, this is going to be a lot of fun. We're going to talk, we're going to share, and we're going to try to connect as salons. I'm a salon owner. I've been a salon owner for 6 years. So I want to really just start off, I want to tell you guys why I'm up here in front of you guys and why I'm not sitting with you, really, because there's no difference between me and you. I own a salon, I run it every day. I just happen to leave it to come here to talk to you, and then I got to go back and run it again. I grew up in Illinois, a small town in Illinois, 750 people. I'm sure some of you guys live in a small town, right? Anybody? Yeah. Popular around here, right, in the Midwest. 750 people in my town, and really never thought about doing hair at all. It was not on my radar as something I liked doing, but what I realized is I was doing hair anyways. I was always changing my hair. Being at a salon was one of my favorite places growing up. When I was growing up, frosting your tips was like the really cool thing. So I was getting my tips frosted with the frosting cap often. I had a good frequency of visit on that. So growing up, I had the idea. I just never put the two together. I tried every job there is. So I have been, in my senior year of high school, I've cleaned toilets at a truck stop. That was my favorite. Third shift when I was 15. Then I worked at Pizza Hut for a while. That's where I got my service industry start. And then in high school, I interned at a radio station, which was really fun. It was actually one of my favorite jobs that I ever had. The challenge with radio is that I got a raise to $12,000 a year, and I was so excited. So there's no money in radio, and obviously we know how things are evolving and changing. And then I started detailing cars. And detailing cars was honestly, I'm going to tell you, one of my favorite jobs I ever did. I love cleaning cars. I don't know what it is about it, but obviously don't make much money doing that either. So one day I went into work, and I worked with a bunch of guys, very manly guys, and I had bleached out my hair. And the guys always laughed about it. And one day this guy said, "My wife is a beauty school teacher. You should go talk to her." And so I did. I called her up that night, and I said, "Do guys do this?" And she said, "Yes." And I was kind of on my way 3 months later, joined beauty school in Davenport, Iowa. Went to school, you need 2,100 hours in Iowa, if any of you guys are familiar, which is a lot of hours. So I went to my first Paul Mitchell hair show. I met a guy named Sam Burns, who's taught here quite a bit. And I decided to move from Illinois to the East Coast near Philadelphia to start my career with Sam Burns. And that's really where it all launched. I left school early in Iowa because I didn't want to stay for the 2,100 hours. You need 1,400 in PA. So I moved, I got my license, started my career with Paul Mitchell, worked for Paul Mitchell for 10 years. You know, that career was fun. I think this job, for all of you guys out there, any of you guys educators? Yeah? So, the thing that I always wanted to do this. I wanted to speak to people. This is where I found my passion in the industry. And I think everybody has their own path. 10 years into Paul Mitchell, I had a lot of great experiences with the company. I loved it. I decided to go off on my own, develop my own company, which is Free Salon Education, with my team back in PA. And you know, we started the company, and from there, it's just blown up over the last couple years. And that's why I ended up here, because we have a big following on YouTube, and people want to have you come places when you have a following on YouTube, because it showcases their company as well. So as we go through today, and we quickly go through it, because this program could easily be a 4-hour program, we're gonna do it in an hour and a half, we're gonna break down all the systems that I use in the salon that made my salon successful. I took my salon about 6 years ago now, and it was not doing well. So me and my wife, we bought the salon 6 years ago. We took it from a failing salon where I couldn't cash my paycheck to the most successful salon in our town. We're booked 3 months in advance. I don't want to be bigger than I am right now. I'm 900 square feet in my town. I do not want to expand. We have to, and that's stuff that we're gonna talk about. But we have a very I have successful stylists. They're 90% rebooking percentage. They're booked out. And now my challenge is, how do I fit more clients in my business? Because right now I can't. That's where, so we went from nothing to that in about 5 years, and we built the YouTube channel and website as well. So I'm gonna share with you guys all of that stuff and how it worked out. And we're gonna start with this question, because it's one of my favorite. Who is your favorite guest in the salon? Anybody have one? Who is it?
Her name's Jan.
Her name's Jan, okay. And why do you like Jan?
Well, first of all, she just has a really great personality. She's very soft and subtle, but she isn't shocked by anything. You can talk to her about anything, and she'll talk to you about anything. But her hair is, it doesn't take a lot of energy out of you, but it's still right. Fun to do, and she tips really well.
Okay. There were key points in that. I don't know if you guys, good conversation, tips well, hair's not that hard, right? So that's good. Anybody else have a favorite? Okay, that's great. So my favorite guest in the salon, and I think I just have a different mindset. I've always been very driven by numbers in the salon business. And my favorite guest is Kathy. I've been doing Kathy's hair for about 10 years. Even if I quit doing hair and have to go do other business things, I would still do Kathy's hair forever. I love her. She comes every single week to the salon. She gets her hair blown out. She gets her hair colored every 3 weeks. We do highlights every other visit. She always gets a great bob haircut. I love doing that, and I love the conversation I have with her. But the reason I love the conversation is because she comes in every week. And that's, so when we talk about, you're relating numbers in a business with relationships, right? So we have somebody that comes in very often. We have a better relationship with them, so they're more of our favorite guest. Our salon is more successful because we build a better relationship with them, so the numbers go up. The whole thing works together, so we have to incorporate numbers whether we like them or not, because we're artistic people. Numbers are still very, very important. Now, who's our least favorite guest? Anybody? This is on film, just so you know. I will blur your face.
Last minute, even right now.
Yeah. Yeah, and they get pissed. You're like, what? Yeah, I know. 3 inches of new growth, right?
And they no-showed their last two appointments.
And they no-showed their last two appointments, and they want to pay the same price as somebody that comes in every week, right?
My least favorite is the one that went to cosmetology
school for a couple months. Yeah. Yeah. That's my, yeah, that's a good one. That might be my favorite ever, actually. I totally agree with you. The thing I like about, so the person that I don't like usually is the person that, well, most of the time they do come in the most often, actually, because you see them constantly and you don't want to. Every time I go in, I swear, there's this guy, Jeff, and he's in my book every single time I go into the salon. I don't know how it happens, but he's always there. And as soon as I see his name, I'm like, oh, damn, I want to quit today. Today is my retirement. So hopefully Jeff's not watching. Here's the other great thing about today and what we're doing. Monaco Blue was gracious enough to let me film today. So if anybody doesn't want to be on film, here's your time to run. And I'll blur you out as you go. But for YouTube, so if you guys want to look back on this class, you can as well. Creating loyalty. People are not loyal unless they have a reason to be. Does everybody agree with that?
Yes.
Right. So how do we get people in our salon to be loyal to our salon? That's a big challenge in the industry. And I think that the problem with this industry right now is that we are so old school right now that we're messing everything up, right? Everything's going with the times. Starbucks now, you don't even have to wait anymore, right? Everybody use the app? Nobody? Does that not happen here? Pretty sure that was nationwide. If I want Starbucks right now, so I'm gonna blow your mind. You didn't even need to come for anything else. At Starbucks now, they have an app, an application for the internet device. And you can literally go on the app, put in the drink that you want, pick the store that you want to pick it up at, and when you get there, it's ready for you, right? So no one's in line today. There is like 3 Starbucks around here. No one has to wait in line. Just order it on your phone, and you'll save a lot of time. The world is all about time, right? The guest that we hate the most is the one that calls that day and they want in, but I'm telling you guys right now, those are the people. That's how it's gonna be now. It's not gonna get better, it's gonna get worse. The only way it's gonna get better is if we focus on rebooking them before they leave. Otherwise, people want in that instant because they're used to it. I ordered clothes for this event Tuesday, and I was so pissed when they didn't get there. They didn't arrive the day before I left to come here. They didn't come, and I was so angry because I'm so used to ordering things and them coming within a day or two from when I order them, right? People in our businesses are gonna do the same thing. They want in. I don't know if you guys have seen, there's apps that are launching. There's an app called Mainstream that's out now. And that app is an on-demand beauty service. So any of you in here could sign up for that app and then go live, and it's Uber for hairdressers. So now somebody could just summon you and you go to their house and do their hair. Whether that's cool or not, I don't know who's on board with that, but that's but that's the reality. I mean, I would never do it because I value my time. I can't drive my car going everywhere, but some stylist that's not busy might want to do something like that. And that client that called in that couldn't get in with you because you're so busy, they are going to do something like that. The loyalty is not going to be there. So how do we create loyalty in the salon? Buy 10 haircuts, get one free is not okay anymore, right? It doesn't do anything to grow our business. So any of you guys, I'm not saying anything, if you guys do a punch card system or something like that now, or you found the app online and you launched it with your business, the reason that this does not work for your business is because it doesn't help grow your clients. It doesn't help your frequency of visit, which we're gonna talk about in a little bit. It just says buy 10 haircuts whenever you want to, and I'll give you a free one someday in life, right? So this could really take them 4 years. So they're not growing your business this way, and you're giving them something for free, which doesn't really work out. Coupons in the paper, obviously, I think we're good. I could probably delete that one, right? I don't even know where the paper is anymore, but I'm pretty sure I can remove that from this presentation. Thirsty Thursday, 2 for Tuesday promotions. Now here's the thing, for those last minute people now, I believe that you gotta stop posting on Facebook, hey, I'm free right now, come on in. But I believe that there is a way that we could do this. If you have the people that call in last minute, you put them on a list, and when you wanna run a promotion or you wanna do something creative, then shoot something to those people that are on that list. Collect the data of last minute people. You know who they are, right? They already are always last minute people. So we can capitalize on them. We have to categorize our customers, right? So I have my customers that rebook all the time. But then what am I doing for the people that don't? And that, besides getting upset with them, right? Now it's time to, just because we're upset about it, now we can fix it, come up with a last minute people list and start pumping this stuff, maybe email them, text them, do something to show them that you have something quick and ready for them. This is our loyalty program. I'm really good friends with Millennium Software that's here, which is kind of cool. I use Millennium Software in my salon business. How many people do not use software? Thank you for not, for being honest. Thank you. And that's good to see, because a lot of times people aren't using software yet. I like Millennium Software. This is a loyalty program that they have built into their system. So I get 500 points for booking a future appointment with your customer. So it's $5. 100 points is $1. It's $5. Earn 1,000 points for referring a friend. Now, I'll give $10 if you refer your friend to my salon business. Why would I give $10 every time? Does that seem like a lot of money? Because if I were to go put an ad in the paper, it would cost me $1,000, and I would maybe get 3 people from that ad. Probably not even 3 people anymore. 1.5, probably. So 1,000 points, I'll give you $10 for referring a friend. If they refer 100 friends, we're good to go. They're making bank and getting their hair done for free, and I've got a ton of their friends coming into my business. 200 points for trying a new service. We have to get people trying something new in our salon. If you don't have time for it, recommend it next time. That's where we fail as hairdressers right now. We get them all psyched up about that visit, and then we let them go. And we don't ask them to come back, right? They come in, they're like, I want this big change. I'm looking for this haircut. I can't wait. We should totally do it today. Let's cut it all off. And then we cut it off. We highlight it. We color it. We send them out. We don't see them for 6 months because we made their day. We need to do what they were booked for, get them excited about the next thing you're going to do with them. Pump them up for next time. Then that way they're going to book sooner and come in. It's not going to cram up your book, and you can book them for new services next time. 200 points for any product purchase over $30, just pushing retail, and then 1 point for every dollar spent. That just makes them feel like they're getting something, but I'm not really giving anything for just spending a dollar. That doesn't keep things moving. This is a loyalty car that we ran in our salon. Now, I'm going to tell you guys right now, the one thing that upsets me the most, I've been through the last 10 years, and I'll watch somebody do a business program, and I'm not saying everyone, there's amazing business people here this weekend. None of the people I'm talking about are here this weekend, but I have gone to their business program, and then I get to know them, and I find out they're not doing any of these things that they say, and it drives me crazy. There's one person in this room right now that I can tell you I know he's doing what he says, and that's Ben back there. Where's your team at? So you can tell who his team is in this room, and I like that. But this is the thing, guys. Everything I'm doing or telling you about, I either did or I'm doing currently. Some things I did, and now they don't work for my business. I have a different model, but I still share them with you because they worked. This is a loyalty card. This was a Starbucks idea of, again, do you guys go to Starbucks? You do, right? At least, okay. So at Starbucks, if you go in the morning and you buy a coffee, they give you a receipt, a treat receipt, right? Robert Cromings does this as well. This was kind of my thought process of it was, maybe I could give you 10% off for something that you want to get. So what we would do is write their name and a date in the future. Now, I wouldn't give you a deal on 4 weeks from now when you want to get your color again. That's not what this is for. This is for maybe I want to get you in for a blow dry. So I'm going to write 2 weeks ahead of time on the card and your name, and then try to get you back in 2 weeks for a blow dry, something that you wouldn't have done, right? So don't give it to them for anything that they would have done already. Give it to them to try something new. Systems. What are some systems you guys run in the salon? Anybody know what a system is?
I don't know. I do one on my phone. It's a client manager app.
Client manager app? And how does that help you?
Oh, it's awesome.
Okay. What's awesome about it?
It gives me many more clients.
Okay.
And they love it because I send them a confirmation of their appointment, and then it reminds them 2 hours before.
Okay.
Or I can set it up any other way.
Okay.
I can set it up either out.
So it's an appointment book type.
Yes.
It's not, and you can put your client list in it. Yeah. Does everybody have a client list manager type thing? Software? STX, okay. So the beauty of the evolution of what's happening now in the industry, we're being able to communicate better with our clients, right? My no-show rate, I have, when we have a no-show, we're like, wow, we had a no-show. Like, it never happens anymore. Because we use a company called Demand Force, but we seriously send them an email. We have an automated person that calls them through voice. We text them 4 times. And then if they don't text back yes, then we call them personally. That's how we will not let you forget. Like, the days of leaving with a card where I write the appointment on the back, that doesn't even happen anymore. They're like, you will let me know. I know it. Because that's what happens in our salon now. We're able to communicate with our guests. That is the number one thing. I'm going to say that was the number one thing 18 times today, but that really is one of the number one things in my mind. Communicating with your guest. What are systems? In my salon, we have a few different things that I think are really important. And I call these systems. Systems is also a good word for software, technology. But the guest greeting is a system because of it's not a rule, but it's a expectation in my salon for my team to say hello to everyone. So no matter what, anybody that walks in the door, I don't care how you say hello, you could be the craziest, weirdest person, and I totally embrace it. I'm not the shake the hand, look in the eye kind of person. I think that's just weird at this point. Hello, thank you. Thank you so much for that. To me, I would rather, hey, like, I want you to be my friend when you come in. You are, everyone that visits our salon, you're our friend. I don't want the stuffy atmosphere. It's not okay. I don't think anybody wants that anymore. So guest greeting is really important. Beverage menu is something that we set up. I'm sure a lot of you guys have this at this point, but it's really just like if you were at your house or I took you to a restaurant, I want you to have options. And I'm the kind of person, if you see me around this weekend, I'm a very quiet person. I don't really talk much until I'm here. I don't know what happens up here, but I don't talk much. I kind of hide, I duck around the corners. So if you ask me if I want something, I'm gonna tell you no, I'm good. I'm good, I don't wanna trouble anybody. That's not the way that I am. So in my salon, I don't want people that are like me to be sitting there dying of thirst because we didn't offer them something and they're not gonna ask for it, right? So we have to cater to people. Station setup, what does your station look like after you finish somebody and before you start the next one? And I'm gonna tell you another thing right now that's gonna be a big haha, cool, like whatever. I don't use assistants in the salon at all. I also have a small salon, so there's different models. I took away assistants about 4 years ago because I think that sometimes there's a disconnection. And because my salon is small, I didn't feel the need for that. So we book up. So the owners in here are like, sweet, all right. And the stylists are like, don't say that, please. But I'm going to tell you right now, and Ted Gibson, who, you know, again, take or leave, not my friend, I don't know, but I did hear him say one time that, you know, he says he charges $1,000 for a haircut. That's totally cool. We can't. I can't. But he doesn't leave his guest the entire time, right? He caters to them. So if you're looking at how do I elevate my salon business, maybe think about that. How much time are you spending with that guest? What type of relationship are you building with that guest right now, right? Why should your haircut be $10 more? Probably if you're spending that extra time with them, giving them the blow dry, shampooing them, building that relationship, that's what it's all about. So just make sure that you're really focused on that relationship. Salon menu, we're gonna talk about. Consultation, important. We're gonna talk about consistent shampoo experience. This is another thing that Paul Mitchell does really well with the wash house. So any Paul Mitchell salon I've been in, I always see some kind of really nice area where we shampoo. The most important thing about that is that you're consistent. And being consistent in a salon business is one of the hardest things, right? It's every owner in here. Where are the owners? Okay. We come up with an idea as a team or whatever, right? It's so good for 1 week, right? It works really well for 1 week. And then next week you're like, what's wrong with them? Like, why can't we? And here's what happens. Because we put it out there, right? First off, we probably came in and we said, you got to do shampoos like really good. That's my salon owner voice. I don't know why. We have to do shampoos really good. go do them, right? And we don't come up, we don't work together on it. You have to work together. All of the, if you have a team and your team is here, that's awesome. Work together, come up with your ideas to do the same shampoo. At my salon, if Justin gives the best shampoo ever, and this lady comes in, she's like, oh my God, that Justin guy, I got the best shampoo ever. She tells her friend comes into my salon and then gets Thad, and Thad's like, whatever, fumble hands, and doesn't do the same shampoo experience. Now their friend is upset, and they talk to their friend that got the good shampoo, and now there's bad dialogue about our business, right? So we have to be consistent, whether it's with the shampoo or anything else. Finishing menu, talk about it. Team contest, we're gonna talk about. Name. This is something Bob McConey, is he in here? No. From Millennium, he owns a salon as well, big salon, which is what I love, because he has a big salon, I have a small one. So sometimes I think, because I have a really tiny space, that I can do different things that some bigger places can't. But Bob's proven me wrong on that, because he's doing some stuff. So the name is so important. How many people have trouble with names in here? Be honest, right? Okay. I'm bad as well. I'm trying to get better though, and I think that's one thing. If you raised your hand, try to get better at it. But the name is so important. And I hate walking through my salon and not knowing people's names. If they're my client or not, most of the time I don't even remember my own client's names, right? Thanks for Millennium, it's written down in there, and I hope it's correct, right? And then we walk up. So what we do is we write the name on the mirror in front of them. So the cool thing about that is we used to do like a little wedding tent thing, and that's how the idea happened. So me and my wife run the salon together, which is really fun and sometimes really, anybody partners that run? Exactly. Me and my wife run it together, and she's always right, and I'm like, I'm always the one with like a million ideas, but she's like such a good reality person. But so we're sitting at a wedding, and everything becomes a salon conversation. So no matter what, I write off every meal because it just doesn't matter, right? Like, whether we're at McDonald's or whatever, it is business the whole time. So name tag at the wedding, we see it. We're like, that's kind of cool. It lets everybody know where they're supposed to be, and then you would know their name. So we started with the name tent. The clients went crazy over it. You'd think it would be like not that big of a deal, and I really did it for my own selfish reasons of not knowing your name 15 minutes into the appointment because I forgot. And now I look down and I have it written down there. Then the name tag, we got different stations, couldn't really, it got a little messy looking, so we got the mirror markers, and we started writing their name on the mirror. And it's really cool because we can write happy birthday to them, you can do little messages if you want to. It brings the experience into a more personal thing, right? So the name is so important, and if you guys can do something like that, Bob said he started doing it and the clients went nuts. So I think, you know, that goes to show you he's got 35, 40 employees. I have 5 employees, but he's making it work and it worked for us. Team contests. All right, so the contest is every week, I like to give out, I'm driven by some cash sometimes. Not gonna lie. Some people are driven by other things. I grew up Midwest small town. My dad was a diesel mechanic. My mom didn't really work. So I always wanted to get out of my town and go do something. I like building businesses. I'm realizing now, like I started selling friendship bracelets in 5th grade. And then I was in a band all through junior high and high school. And I couldn't wait to print the CDs and the labels and, you know, start selling them for $1 at every show. Like, I think that that's always been in me. So whatever drives you guys, but this is cool because this focuses on the things that are gonna grow your business, right? And you can focus on these numbers. And who's been doing hair for 1 year in here? Anybody? 1, 2 years? Okay, who's been doing hair for 20? Okay, and all of you in between, congratulations as well, that's good. So 2 years, right, 20 years. It's like we separated the whole, the young people over here and the older people. I'm gonna move, I'm getting more towards this area. So you can compete with them, right? If you try to compete with them on a weekly number basis or the dollar amount that you bring in, you couldn't compete. Hopefully you're blowing them away, right? But on service per guest, retail per guest, and rebooking, it doesn't matter if they have 10 clients and you have 100, you're gonna have the same numbers, right? So you can compete. I can compete with the young kids, no matter how much money I bring in. So service per guest is how many services they're doing per guest. Easy breakdown. Retail per guest, same thing, and rebooking percentage. Those are the three key factors when you're trying to grow your business. So what I do is for each of those categories, I love that I write that out, like, whatever. Sometimes it's a late night and I'm like, winner gets $10, like, all right, I could have just said that. I'm actually starting, I was doing this and I'm like, PowerPoints are so lame. Like, I don't even want to do a PowerPoint, but I feel like it still needs to happen. Like, I feel like we could just talk about everything. So the winner gets $10 of each category. So if service per guest, if Brian brings in the most, then I give him $10, and I give Thad for rebooking and somebody else for whatever, or you could win $30. Maybe that doesn't seem like a big deal, but it's gas for the week. It's $120 a month if you win them all. So it's kind of a big deal. And for a salon owner, I think $30 a week is pretty fair to give out. And they fight. Like, they fight for this, and it's hilarious because at the end of the day on Saturday, I see them like checking their numbers, and they hope that somebody forgets, because if you forget, you're out of the contest, right? So you have to write them down to be in it. Now here's the menu. At my salon, I've done a lot of different menus. I'm a menu guy, but I'm also like not a fancy menu guy. So anytime I go into a salon, I see like a really fancy brochure, which works for some businesses again. I have no idea what any of it means. If I go to a fancy restaurant and it doesn't have pictures of the food, I get so angry. And I'm getting better at like reading the description and being like, oh, it sounds delicious. But really, I just want to see the picture of like the juicy. It's never going to look like that, but I just want to pretend. So we created a menu. This is the front page. It's actually one of my stylists, Drea. Second page opens up to our starters. My wife is from the restaurant business. She worked in it for 16, 17 years. So she has a lot of ideas with menus and stuff. So we did starters, like appetizers. That's all shampoo experience stuff. We did Paul Mitchell treatments. We're a Paul Mitchell focus salon. Kara Triplex Retreat is a keratin treatment. And then Hey Sugar Sugar is their sugar scrub with lavender mint shampoo conditioner. I don't want to overcomplicate anything. I don't want to have 95 options for people, but I think it's cool to just have a little tiny upgrade that people can get. We have our haircut prices. We're the cheapest place in town and we're the most expensive. And that was always my model. We opened in 2009, so times weren't good, right? Those of you that had a salon at that point, people just quit coming. Like, they started pushing everything off, right? Well, we opened, and that's when I say I couldn't cash a paycheck and all of that, it had a lot to do with those times. And it was, who was a salon owner before that time and went through that? I love every single one of you guys, because that was tough, right? That was a big deal. So you really got to look at, when I couldn't cash my paycheck, it was when you get to a business is not fun. Like, a lot of you guys out there that, are stylists now and maybe thinking about being a salon owner later in life or whatever, it is hard work, right? So I commend anybody in here that does that, and it's really half the reason why I do this. The other half is to, you know, I like getting up here, and the other half is really just being a part of you guys, because this is, it's a hard business, it's a lonely business, and nowadays with the internet, it's getting more social. It's becoming a little bit easier, I think, in that way. But we're up late at night trying to figure out how to pay you guys, you know, because there's a lot that goes into it. So I came out, we were the cheapest and the most expensive. I didn't want to be just the cheapest, because I don't think that that shows your brand the way you should. And I wanted to give people options. So if you don't want to pay a lot of money, that's cool. But those people that still weren't struggling through that whole thing can come in and pay the more expensive prices. We have a breakdown of why we have multiple price structures. And I also believe that the only way you're going to keep staff in your salon is to offer them incentives to grow their career with your business. Because right now, if you're all the same and you're on the same playing field, then they don't know where to grow from there. The only way they can grow from there is to open their own, right? So we got to show them, and it's not giving them more percentage necessarily, okay? And stylists in here, don't worry about the percentage. The percentage is awesome. You get a lot of what you bring in, but being priced more expensive and growing yourself. So a lot of people, when I first moved to Philadelphia, Sam was like, oh, I love how you cut hair. I hadn't even worked in a salon yet. I worked there for 2 months. He took my haircuts from $40 and raised them to $75. I think I had like four clients. So I spent the next 3 years trying to build a book on a $75 haircut with no reputation whatsoever, except for the new kid in town kind of thing, right? So it took me forever. Now, I will not move you to a higher price point unless people cannot get in with you. If people can get in, if you have room in your book, you're not ready to move, right? And that's the mindset that we have to get in, because if you move too quick, then you're just, there's no reason. You should be sweating behind the chair and so booked, and clients should be begging to get in, and then you raise your prices and you don't have that problem with, are my clients gonna be upset? Because I promise you, when you say, I'm making more room for you guys, because some people are not gonna wanna pay my prices, it'll be okay. And you won't have to worry about that. So different levels of pricing, I think, is really important. This is our color menu, cool little Paul Mitchell Inkworks image. And also, this says starters. Every time I do this program, I'm like, I need to fix that. It's supposed to say sides, so I put up the wrong one. But we have color, regular prices there, and then sides. The sides are single foils, treatments that can go on the ends, glazes, Olaplex, you know, all of those different things go on there. Blow dry bar. How we feel about this? Think it's great? Anybody else? Anybody not think it's great? Okay. I'm going to change your mind. And I have a salon too, and I don't have a blow dry bar. So here's the thing. $20 million in sales. This is dry bar statistics, right? That company dry bar. 23 salons in 6 states, and actually this has grown a lot. This is not up to date, but 50,000 women per month, so it's bigger than this. 50,000 women per month are going to get their hair blown dry at Dry Bar, right? Why are we upset? Because we feel like they're taking from what we're doing. But why we shouldn't be upset is because they took something that we weren't promoting and doing well and made a company around it. The beauty of this whole entire thing and why we shouldn't be upset is we have blow dryers in our businesses and chairs and every bit of equipment that they have. We just have to utilize it. So why can't you say you have a dry bar in your place? If you type in blow dry bar in New Hope, Pennsylvania, I come up first. And I'm the only one there because I'm the only salon that decided to put blow dry bar somewhere in my website. So now if they search for a blow dry bar, I come up. And then I have a blow dry bar. Oh, here's the other thing. Average dry bar net profit is 15% to 35%. I know none of you guys are seeing that percentage in your salon business for profit right now. Average salon is 11%. And here is our blowout bar menu. This is one of our clients. You have three different steps to your blow dry. We created an experience around it to compete with the dry bar companies. I'm gonna put up this wedding hair thing, but because this is an open book and I'm open with you guys, I quit doing wedding hair in my salon because we are so busy now that weddings were affecting the business. And I'm actually in a huge tourist town. Thousands of people every weekend come to my town, New Hope, Pennsylvania, and there's a lot of weddings, but we have to turn them all down because our clients that are our regulars, we'll do their hair for their wedding, but our clients that are regulars couldn't get in to get their hair colored. So I quit doing, so I erased this from our website. And if anybody calls, we recommend somebody else. It's just how we're rolling right now. But there's our menu for that. We used to do mimosas and we would shut down the salon for bridal parties because we're small, but financially it just wasn't smart, so. Consultation. And really that goes to show, like, you don't have to do everything. And I think we try to throw in every single aspect of the beauty industry that we can. My salon's really good at cut, color, and styling, and blow dries or whatever. So that's what we do. We don't do anything else. Like, the trends that come and go, sometimes I don't jump on them because I just want to be good at what we're good at and focus on it. This is a hair analysis card that we have done in the past. Right now I have my staff that's been with me for 4 years. This has become very regular dialogue for us. But this card could be filled out by your assistants, maybe your new stylist. For every client that comes in, you put their name, their starting level, percentage of gray, check their density, texture, formation. Why do I need to know all this stuff? Anybody? If you're coloring, affects your coloring. And what does it affect the client? Why does the client need to see it happen? Cost, right? So if I circle, you have a high density of hair, I'm right away going to turn the dialogue into, I'm going to have to use more hair color on you. So it's going to be a little bit more than the price. So we get price out of the way right at the beginning. Because if you don't do that and you surprise them at the end with this high, ridiculous price, they're not going to understand it and they're not going to come back. Again, it's all about relationship. How many people hate going to the car mechanic? Right? Why? Because we have no idea what they're charging us for. They just say a bunch of stuff and then it's over $1,000 every time and we pay it and it just is what it is and we put them off until our car is falling apart and then we take it back in there, right? Because we don't have that relationship. You gotta build the relationship in there. Take inspiration from everywhere. This is, so I just put up a video about this on YouTube from a presentation I did with Millennium, actually. I was at a Millennium event in Miami in January of this year. And I quickly needed an energy drink in the morning, and the Starbucks app wasn't invented yet. So I went across the street to this grocery store. And when I say I've done every job, this is another job that I've done, is third shift stocking shelves. And again, I think it's with the car detailing. I just love seeing this. Like this, what do you guys see there? Everything's faced. It looks beautiful. This is what a grocery store looks like at 6 a.m. in the morning. I don't know if you guys have ever been in there. You should try it sometime. It's pretty cool. And then people just come in and tear it apart, and then somebody has to go back in and reface them and make them look beautiful again that night. And he's doing that for like $7.25 an hour. So when you guys look at being upset because you got to face 10 products in your salon and make them look nice, look at this guy's job. But that's not why I put that up there. This, in the salon, you think about, this is what a grocery store looks like. What does your salon retail look like? Right? When you think about your salon right now, if we could all go walk into each of your salons right now, when you quickly ran out yesterday after work and left it however it was, hopefully we didn't all do that, but in reality, I probably did the same thing. What does it look like? Does it look like that? That's what it should look like all the time. You gotta put in the effort. So I see those things and I just think, all right, I need to go back to my salon and redo how we stock everything. I like everything looking like it's about to fall off the shelf. Like, catch it, purchase it, take it home. That's what I want to happen. If I could have a lever to just kind of shove it off, that would be pretty cool. This is another app for your phone. It's the World of Beers. This is something that, another thing in Miami. So after the grocery store, and then I did my presentation, we went out that night, and we went to a place called World of Beers. And John Harms, the owner of, founder of Millennium, and I were sitting there, and I looked at this wall. This wall represents the number of alcoholic beverages this person has consumed. 2,186 at that place. Like, this is a corporate place, but that's that person. She was there that day, obviously. She doesn't go anywhere else, but. So she's there, and I guess when she drank her, like, 2,187th beer, they rang a bell really loud and celebrated her. So this got me thinking. I try to take everything that I see, because you have these companies out there. We don't have a lot of money. We're salon owners, and it's just the reality of it. And, you know, if you have some money, that's great. You're doing a great job. But it's not like the crazy business where we're now flying in our private jet because we're late for our client, you know. So here's the deal. How can we celebrate our clients? Services, right? How many services they had for the year? Put the number one person up there, right? That could be kind of cool. These companies have millions of dollars worth of marketing and advertising and all that. They spend so much time learning how people think and what will make them excited. I don't have millions of dollars yet. Just kidding. So I take this idea and I transfer it into my business. It's not that easy. Starbucks, you see the treat receipt thing. You can transfer it into your business. Every single thing that's happening, from the way that the girl answers the phone at our hotel this weekend, I don't know if you guys have called room service, they're the nicest people. And I couldn't find, I was like looking on the phone for like food, dry cleaning, like usually they have like different sections. This is like you call one person and she'll do whatever you want for her, right? So that goes to show you, like, you can transfer that stuff to your business. Making a comeback. We really already talked about that. That making a comeback is getting them excited about the next visit. We're gonna jump into numbers real quick. I promise this won't be boring. What can frequency of visit do for your business? Anybody? Make more money. Does anybody know what their frequency of visit is now? Stylist, does anybody know what their frequency of visit is? For you, for your business, per week, does anybody have any clue what that number is? If you don't know what that number is, you have to go look it up. You have to figure out what this number is, because this number will change your business. I promise you, you need to know this number. Here's why. Average client returns every 12 weeks. It's $50 per client. Let's say an average ticket of $50, right? They come 4 visits a year. Did you know that I'm about to break stuff? Did you know that the average client visits a salon about 4.6 times a year? 4.6. That's their frequency of visit, is 4.6 times a year. That's every 3 months, basically. A little less. So how do we get them to come back in? If we change up our frequency of visit, our goal is every 4 to 5 weeks, getting them in for their color at $50 a client. So I take that $200 client, I get them to come in more often, and now they're a $600 client. I didn't upgrade them. I didn't ask for a raise and get more commission. I started making more money because I talked, and I got them to come back in sooner. Now, the next thing, pre-booking. Pre-booking needs to be, like, there shouldn't be a question anymore of, are you pre-booking your appointment? Like, unless you, people know their schedules now. People know what's going on. You need to tell them when they're coming back. You're the expert. You don't say to them, would you like to come back in 4 weeks? Can I get you rescheduled? Don't ask anything. I have clients that I pre-book them 9 appointments without even telling them, because they know that they have to come back. And they know that because my schedule is so busy, they have to come back. If your schedule is not busy, pretend that it's busy, right? Get them to rebook. Stephen Terry Cohen, you guys know who that is? They're pretty close to here. This is what changed my pre-booking. When they said, they gave ways of pre-booking. And they said, did you have trouble getting in today? If you say yes, that's perfect, that's easy, right? They say yes, well then let's get you pre-booked for next time so that you don't have that problem anymore. Easy, done. If you say, no, I had no problem, it was easy, you called, you got in. Then you say, well, a lot of my clients are having trouble, so let's get you pre-booked before you leave. Start the dialogue as soon as they sit down in the chair. If you do that, then by the end, you're not shocking them. By the end, your client is checked out. They can't wait to get out of there. As much as you think they love you, they can't wait to move on to the next thing, right? You're taking up an hour and a half, 2 hours of their day, right? And I had to realize that, because I thought people just loved hair as much as I did. They really don't. They don't care. I see them out and about and I'm like, what? That's what you got out of what I did, right? So people don't care. They don't have time. They don't, so they're only spending that time so that one time that month when they go out in front of their friends, they don't have gray hair. Other than that, they would not care. They would sit in their PJs at their house drinking wine and not caring about their head, right? We love hair. So we need to love their hair for them and get them excited to pre-book. Average ticket. So we broke down just a regular $50 average ticket, 12 visits a year. So now we've got our frequency of visit at 12. It's a $600 client. If we just add a simple conditioning treatment, haircut, whatever, to bump that up to an $85 average ticket, now you have 12 visits a year and they're a $1,020 client. So you're taking somebody that was coming in as much as the average client is with a $50 average ticket, which is pretty normal, right? For you guys, if you look at your average ticket, it's probably around 50 bucks. If it's higher than that, congratulations. But $50 is a pretty basic number. 12 visits a year, so from $200 to $1,020, and this is stuff that you can do tomorrow, right? Maybe not tomorrow, Monday, we're all closed. Tuesday, you can do it Tuesday, right? So this is simple, simple stuff. It will change the entire way that you're doing hair. It'll change your salon, it'll change your paycheck. Industry average single color every 12 weeks is $50. So this is what the typical stylist is doing right now. 250 guests, $50 average ticket, 4 visits a year is $50,000 a year. That's what you bring in, that's not what you take home, right? So our average stylist is sitting between $17,000 and $25,000 a year. And that's not okay. It's not okay with me. I don't think it's okay with anybody in this room, right? So what we do to change that is everything I just talked about. Tuesday, you can fix it. Tuesday, you can start being this person, and it doesn't matter what happened in the past. It doesn't matter what clients you have. Same clients, you can do this exact same thing. Single color, haircut, treatment, right? Three things, three services. Average ticket, $110, not unattainable. 250 guests, harder to do, get your reputation up. 12 visits a year, $330,000 a year. That's, now, I don't know currently a stylist doing this. And I'm not gonna say that my stylists are doing it. The most I've ever brought in is $175,000 a year doing hair. And that wasn't take home, that was bringing in, right? $330,000 a year, but it can be done. And you could say, what, who has a big dream, big goal in here? Anybody? What's yours?
To move out of state somewhere.
Move out of state?
Yeah.
Okay.
I actually am in limbo opening my own right now.
Okay. So that's your big dream. Who else? Who has a big?
I want to own my own home.
Own your own home. All right.
I'm too old to enjoy it.
All right. I'm with you. Anybody else? Buy you a boat. And this is the thing. Mine is to buy a suite at Lincoln Financial Center so I can watch the Eagles from a suite every weekend. That's all I want, right? Am I ever gonna be able to do it? I don't know. I really don't know. But it can be done. It can be done. Are any of you gonna bring in $330,000 a year as a stylist? I don't know, but it can be done. Easily, as long as you follow this stuff and you start focusing on your numbers. Bob McConey had somebody come up to him, and I don't know if they're in here or not, but I'm gonna tell you, they said they have a paper appointment book, which is totally cool. I get the struggle with technology, but things are moving quickly, and that is way back there. We have already trampled that, right? But they said to Bob, I don't need software, I just need to know when my client's coming in. And that's it. And if the power goes out, what am I gonna do, right? And the reason I'm telling you guys this is because you need to know way more than whether your client's coming in or not, right? We have to know more. We can't grow, we will always be this. This is without computer software. And I don't even care if you buy Millennium, to be honest. I love the guys, but I don't work for them. But I'm gonna tell you right now, you're gonna be this person. It's very difficult not to be if you're not keeping track of what you're doing, okay? So to get to this, you have to study your numbers. And they're just a few numbers, nothing big deal, and you can get a report on them. So whatever software you're using in here, find those reports and look at them. This is Rob Dyrdek. I love him. I'm actually in the process right now of finding my fantasy factory. I'm looking for a 5,000 square foot warehouse space that I can make a salon in a little bit of it, and free salon education, filming, editing, offices, shipping, and all of that at the same time. Probably a half pipe in there too. I don't know, but I think it's gonna happen. But I like this saying, make your own luck, because it really is. People, there's a couple people that look at you and they say you're a lucky person, but it doesn't take luck to be good at what you do. Like, it doesn't take luck to buy a salon. I had a client who I was struggling in the salon business I was in. I had moved 1,000 miles from my family. I was by myself. Met my wife 3 months into moving, but thankful for her, I would have quit and went back to Illinois if I wouldn't have met her. But I had a guy, 3 years into working, I wanted to grow as a salon stylist and be a salon owner someday. I never thought about owning a salon. And I had one of my clients say, I was cutting his hair, and he said, where's Sam? I said, Sam moved to California. And he said, really? And I'm like, yeah. And he goes, well, why didn't you buy this from him? And I said, well, I can't, because I don't have the money to buy it from him. And he said, I've been watching you for 3 years. I know what you can do. Call Sam when you get home and offer him whatever amount of money. And that's what I did. I called him, I offered him money. Sam was so excited, because it was, you know, he didn't want me to not have a job, but he was moving on to other things. So he was trying to keep it open. I offered it to him. I did a quick loan with this guy for 3 years. I paid off the business, and it became me and my wife's. But that might seem like luck, but it's not luck, because he was watching. If I would have just been doing my thing, having a good time, laughing, joking, I 100% of the time, besides maybe tonight at the little party thing, am thinking about my businesses right now. Free salon education is number one. I love being able to provide free education for everybody. My salon is right there. I'm in it all week long. You have to be in it. You make your own luck, because it doesn't take luck. You create that. You do it. Membership is the last thing. I don't do memberships. I do men's memberships at my salon now. I took away the women's again because we got so busy. But before we were busy, when we weren't busy, these memberships were awesome. We had a platinum membership, and we have a regular membership. So you pay $160 per month. You get your color for free, not free, but it's included, a haircut, and a blow dry once a week for $160. Now, how many people think that $160 sounds cheap for that? Okay. Why is it not cheap?
It's every month.
It's $160 12 times a year, right? So I will give you a couple extra, and I'm gonna tell you right now, nobody came in once a week, and you probably could change it to 2 times a month if you wanted to. This is fully customizable. But this really came up because I think memberships is, you're seeing memberships become a big thing, right? Nobody buys music anymore. They are on a membership. Nobody rents movies anymore, you're on a membership. YouTube now is offering, coming up, a membership. People wanna be on a membership. The other great thing is, it's a guarantee that they're gonna come in. So I'll give you a little bit of a deal if you're gonna definitely come in and pay me every 4 weeks for your services. The men's membership is the same. It's $75 per month. That includes unlimited haircuts. They come in once a week. I love seeing my guys every week, because you seriously could just blow on their head and they're good. Like, it takes like 3 seconds to finish. It's like cleaning up the neck. Whoever told a guy to come in every 4 weeks was out of their mind. Unless you're growing it for something, there's no reason a guy should do that. So we got to get guys in. Our guys, it's definitely every 2 weeks with the membership. They come in every week, and we just clean them up, detail them. They're out in 10 minutes. So it's worth the time. This is our men's menu. Just giving them options. We shave their neck. We do hot towel treatments, different things with them. It's all part of our book, picture menu. This is a pretty old school image, but this is something we did a long time ago. I color 80% of the guys that sit in my chair. 80% of them get color. And I know, and I'm going to tell you right now, it's not because of my area. So a lot of people would be like, well, guys around here would never color their hair. If you make it cool and you give it to them for free for the first time, it's getting them hooked on it. And then you look at average ticket, frequency of visit. Guys come in 12 to 24 times a year. This free service that you give them one time that takes half an ounce of color could now turn into $20 every 2 weeks added onto their ticket. So that's a big deal as well. So I offer it for free if you haven't tried it. Because no guy, I did concrete construction, another job, and they used to call me Eminem because I had like bleached out crazy hair. But like guys don't want to look like that. That's what they think hair color is going to do to them. So if you show them for free one time that they won't look any different, like guys will pay you to make them look nothing different than when they walked in. It's awesome. So take advantage of that. All right, don't know who said this, but there's three types of workers: those who get things done, those who watch things get done, and those who wonder how so much got done. This is for real, right, in the salon. We always have different levels of people. And as I kind of sum up this, we still have a little bit of time, but I want to, I'm gonna do some question and answer stuff. This is the reality of a salon and any business there is, right? You have people that work really hard. So you have the salon owner, like me, like you guys, some of you guys out there, that all you think about, like I said, when we go to McDonald's, we go wherever, it is business the whole time. Then you have that stylist that is it's the one that you know gets it, right? We all have that one, or maybe two. If we're lucky, a little bit more than that, but it's harder to find. Then you have your workers under that who just do really good hair, right? And then you have the people that one false move and we're getting them out, right? So that's what a salon is made up of, that, right? And what I had to realize is that nobody's gonna love my salon as much as me, ever. Right? Nobody's gonna love your salon as much as you do. It's your salon. So to get somebody else to be on the same page takes a lot. But if you get them involved in it, you're gonna have a better time doing it. Ben, where's Ben's staff? So you guys are in Chicago, right?
Yeah.
Anybody come from further than Chicago?
Newcastle, Indiana.
Where?
Newcastle,
Indiana. Okay, cool. How do you get people, young people, to drive? Did you guys take a bus? How'd you get? You drove?
Yeah.
Three cars? How did you get a group of people to come 3 hours away? Why'd you guys come? Did he force you?
Is it? Expanding.
You're expanding soon? Yeah.
A little bit of education and
okay.
Deciding to do more bonding with each other and to get re-inspired.
Yeah.
Especially before the holidays and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's cool, it gets your guests excited. And they think you're so cool that you're going on a trip for a weekend, and
right.
The next time they come in, they're gonna ask you about it and get to know all the stuff you learned and the technicality of behind what we do, because it's a serious business.
Yeah. This is why I get so angry when people talk about millennials. And there's a book. I'm gonna steal it. There's a book over there about millennials. But I'm right on the edge of the millennial thing, so I throw myself over there. But like, that's what, there is that in the industry. It's hard to find. I know that, but a lot of people ask me the question of how do I get people, how do I get people in my salon? How do I get stylists that are inspired and want to work? And you can't get them. They don't come. You have to go get them. You have to go find them. You have to go to, what school did you guys go to?
Paul Mitchell.
Paul Mitchell? Anybody not Paul Mitchell? Ben, and I would be calling out a lot of you guys if I knew you, but I'm going to get to know you tonight, and I'll call you out next time. But here's the deal. Ben, I know, because I watch him on social media, Christian puts out some of the most awesome education videos. Ben and Christian flew all over the country on their own dime to teach at Paul Mitchell schools all over the country. And they're young, and they probably were able to do that, and some of us can't. But there are schools near you, and that's all that matters. You don't have to travel the whole country. But the reason that they have a stack full of people right now that couldn't wait to be here is because he went into all those schools, and they got to know him. So if you guys are looking for hungry energy people, find the schools. There's a school here that did a presentation today, right? Was it today?
Yeah.
Those are hungry kids. I would go scrape them up right now. All of you, run and get them. Because that's who you need. That's your future. This, and then we'll do a little bit of Q&A. Does everybody feel pretty good? I have a half an hour, right, still? Or a little less than that? 20 minutes? Oh, cool. All right, we're good. This is a movie theater. So I did a lot of, when I left Paul Mitchell, I did a lot of education with the distributorship, a big distributor. And so I was driving every single weekend an hour from my house to teach. And every weekend I would drive by and look at this old theater and just think, like, who goes there? Like, I don't know who would go to that theater. And then eventually I went by there and it says, "That's all, folks. Thanks for 30 years." So that movie theater 30 years ago was probably the coolest theater there is, right? Now, no one would go in that theater, obviously. That's why they closed down. But why wouldn't they go? Why wouldn't you choose this theater?
Didn't change
with the times. It's old school, right? It's now, when you go to a movie theater, somebody waits on you. They have alcoholic beverages. They have Lazy Boy recliners, right? I pick my seat via the app. I choose that I don't have to sit in the front row, but I can show up late.
It'll come to our town.
You don't have that?
No.
Sometimes I forget. So
the armrest goes up.
It's like, sometimes the armrest goes up. That's cool. That's really cool. This, the armrest did not go up on this. Yeah. But that's it. So 30 years ago, they opened their business very excited to be a movie theater. 30 years later, they look exactly the same as they did 30 years ago, with the same probably angry, upset employees, have no motivation, haven't grown. Like, nothing was working out with this business, so they closed their doors because they couldn't compete with all of the other businesses. Now, the average salon will not last 10 years. Who's had a salon over 10 years? You know why? Because you're here, right? The average salon isn't here this weekend. I don't think any of you guys are average salons, and I don't know you yet, but I will. And so average salons do not come to these things. They don't take the time. They don't invest the time in learning the business so they can grow. Most hairdressers became salon owners because they hated their boss and they wanted to do it on their own. Right? So is there anybody that was like, "I love my boss, but I'm just going to go open," not the ones that have their boss here. It's good sucking up, though. I like it. So I think that's that. So real quick, and then let's do some question and answer for a few minutes. And again, if you guys want to watch this, as long as everything was successful, which doesn't always happen in recording stuff, looks like everything's still blinking, you could watch this on YouTube again if you want to write more stuff down. Now, Free Salon Education is the company that I started 2 years ago. We grew from really organically through YouTube for the most part. It was really just me. I think like a lot of people just, I was an educator. I wanted to put out education. I love building websites and everything you see on Free Salon Education. I didn't outsource anything at this point. I do all of it. So I'm actually only working in the salon a day and a half a week now to take care of my clients still that I love, like Kathy. But I, and yeah. That's another reason. Every time I'm like, I could retire today, it would be fine. So Free Salon Education, so now I got my team involved now. So we're all putting out videos. We do, last week I think we put out 8 videos, step-by-steps, podcasts, business videos. You guys can ask questions on social media and we'll answer them that week on the videos. So it's really an open source for you guys to be able to, if you're having that question late at night and you don't know the answer, I don't know if I do either, but we can work our brains together and try to figure it out, and we'll do it live over YouTube. So all you have to do is submit a question and we'll answer it. And then, you know, we're trying to just provide quality education. That was always my plan, for free, because this you pay for, because this is person to person. This is hands-on, one-on-one. But on the internet, I believe that education should, you know, is free in my mind, and I will make the companies pay for it. So that was always my goal, is to get the corporations to pay, and I will keep giving you guys stuff for free. So as long as that keeps happening, we'll keep going. Social media, we're all over it. Facebook, Instagram, all of that. We're friends now, right? So it's all Free Salon Education. Twitter is at Salon Education. How some company didn't have Salon Education, I don't know. And that's pretty much it. So let's do some questions, a few. I have 15 minutes, I think.
What booking software did you say you use in Salon?
In my salon, we use Millennium software. So if you guys are looking for a change in software or whatever, go talk to Bob. He's really awesome and knows a lot of stuff. Yeah.
As an owner, which do you think is best, having employees or like independent contractors, 1099?
So,
that's a good question.
It's a really good question. I've been asked this before. Should we have individual? It's a good point. I should repeat these questions. That picture is alive. He didn't like that question, just jumped right off the wall. Be careful, that could fall more. All right, so the question was, would you prefer 1099 employees or like a W-2, right? So I don't want my staff to worry about any of that stuff. I like running, and I know that Salon is a very easy business to make not so legit fully. I'm actually not looking at anybody in here because I'm sure we're all very legit. But I really like the W-2 aspect, even though it falls more on me. It's costly. It really is. But I believe that I'm going to have more, a better relationship with my people if we're all in it together and I'm helping provide, you know, that stuff. Because at the end of the year, I work 1099 on a lot of things, and that's a tough, like that's tough for people. So, and I think a W-2 is just easier for your staff if they want to go buy a car or a house or whatever. It's just an easier process. I think if there's other ventures that they do, like some of my staff will do some video shoots with me or whatever, and I'll pay them. Sometimes that's more of a 1099 feel, or if they go out and educate, that is. But in the salon, I like doing the W-2. That's my opinion, but so I hope that helps. Yeah.
How did you go about like charging that? How did your guests pay for that? How did you implement it?
So it's totally going to sound like a millennial.
How did you sell that on them? And then
right.
How did you, how did they pay for it?
It's going to sound like a Millennium commercial, but Millennium does it all for you. So you put together packages. You say, I want, it's this much per month. You sign them up, you swipe their card, and every month Millennium, just like a gym, takes it out. So it's, you don't have to worry about anything. So when we run payroll, our employees get paid 45% of the transaction. So if they signed up on the 25th of the month and the transaction comes out the 25th of the month, I pay them 45% of that, which has been really good. I mean, if you think about it's all about the frequency of visit. You know, that's an over $2,000 a year guest, and most guests are not spending that. They're like riding that $1,000 line a year, and that's a color and cut client. So really, it's a good thing, and the commission works best for me, I think. A couple more?
I was just wondering, do you have any role models in this industry, and what do you do to advance your own education?
So good question. Do I have any role models, and what do I do to advance my education? So. I do have role models. I'm getting to a point in my life now, like my wife tells me all the time, like I study someone so much. Like I study you until I can get nothing else out of you, and then I move on to the next person. So I did that with Robert Cromings at the beginning of my career. I listened to his CDs over and over and over. I could probably rehearse those CDs to you. Stephen Terry Cohen was the same way. And then outside of like Paul Mitchell, DJ Muldoon, I've always loved the way he cuts hair. And you know, so it's, you, I always study people, but the problem is now in my life, I start to become that person. Like it's really weird. So, and it's something I'm actually really fighting with. Like I'm becoming like I'm an original person, but I'm made up of like 15 people, right? So right now I'm really into Gary Vaynerchuk, who is has nothing to do with the hair industry, but he's a very social media guy. And I've studied him so much the last couple months that I'm like, I just have to quit watching because my mind starts to get messed up. So now in my life, I'm really just looking at myself I need to start just picking myself apart to put out original stuff, because I think we get wrapped up in watching somebody, and then I think it's good to start to imitate a bit, but when you really want to be like an original person, you kind of have to let that go. And my wife's really good at telling me that you're acting too much like somebody else, you know? I get a text every single time I'm about to walk up here that says, just be yourself, please. You know? And that's, I don't even know if that's an awe. I think that's like, dude, seriously? Like, just be yourself. But yeah, it's, you know, it's a good thing, but that's, so there's been a lot of people, and I think it's good to have those people. So right now I'm just really, I'm trying to pick apart me and figure out the actual like person. Now,
when you decided to start food salon education, how did you separate that from doing hair?
So I didn't, and I think that's why. So how did I start, when I started food salon education, how did I separate that from doing hair? If you walk into my salon today, I seriously have 900 square feet that is packed. I purchased $30,000 worth of live broadcasting equipment. It's right next to my color bar, like in the salon. I have lighting that's like that they use on TV sets, all lining my salon, that when we plug them in, it lights up like a football stadium. But that's just, we warp it into free salon education. I think the reason that free salon education is working is because we are real. We are a real salon in a really small town that is on the internet trying to do big things. And I think because we're real, that's another reason why I do hair a day and a half a week. I honestly could really use that time to not be doing hair, but I feel like if I stop doing hair, I'll lose what has made me kind of who I am. You know, like I know the salon industry because I'm behind the chair, and I know that I have Jeff that ruins my day, and I know that I have Kathy, and you know what I mean? Like, so that's been, so that's, I didn't separate it.
How do you keep yourself focused
on
that?
Focus is hard. Yeah, I'm doing a lot. So I always thought, like, business to me, like you guys all in here, you all either run a salon or you work behind a chair. I don't do anything else. Like, I don't have, this is my fun, right? So it started out, like, I liked editing video and I liked shooting education videos. I started doing this because Paul Mitchell wouldn't hire me to go out and shoot a DVD. I was like, well, hell, I'll just do it myself. You know, like, I'm not gonna wait for them, you know? So that's why I started this company, you know? And you put out one video, and it was literally like us, me and Thad, drinking beer, one really tiny camera that I had, and we just shot the video, and that video has like 500,000 views now from 2 years ago. And then we just, then when I started rolling through, then we, I got a couple companies that wanted to start sponsoring, so I started reaching out to companies, and Mizutani Scissors was a big one. They reached out to me, and I really just wanted a free pair of scissors. That was my whole goal. And it's like, man, if I can make a video and get a free pair of scissors, I'm like, I've made it. And then he sent me the scissors, and I loved them. And so I was like, all right, well, maybe I can sell them. So we started using them on the videos, and they started selling. So then there's money. So then I started buying more cameras. And my staff thought I was crazy, because every 2 days there was more and more cameras and just equipment. So it was stocking up, because you never know when it's going to be over, right? Like, you don't know, like, if everything quits today, I'm still a hairdresser, I still own a salon, and I still have lots of cameras. So I can do whatever I want with that. But I don't even remember what the question was. I don't know where I was going with that, but, you know, time. So that's what I spend all my time. I have a 7-year-old son. Sounded like I said 70. Seven. 7-year-old son that I love. And so I do stuff with him. I help coach his football team. And I do this. And that is it. All day I wake up, I do this, clean the house a little bit, take my son to school with my wife. We have dinner together. We talk about this. We sit down to watch a TV show. I'm doing this. She's on her phone. We don't even watch the TV show. Like, this is what we do. So I think if you want to make anything from your life, if there's something, that big goal that you're looking for, you just got to go do it. Don't worry about the time. You'll make time. And if it's that important, you will do it. If it's not that important, you won't. And it doesn't matter. Like, not everybody has to do something like this, but it's your choice. I have a class on free salon education and YouTube at the end of the day today. So if any of you guys want to come back for that, we're going to discuss. I'm going to show you guys how to film and how to make a good video. I brought some equipment with me. We're going to do it together, which would be pretty fun. And that's pretty much it. John, did you have anything? I thought I saw your hand fly up like 5 times and I felt bad. Yeah. So my salon, so how often do we as a team meet? We actually, so our podcast, we do a live podcast every Wednesday night. That started by us just having our weekly kind of get together to talk about hair. So then we started doing the podcast. So that's kind of our weekly get together. And then quarterly, we go out as a team and we do something fun, karaoke or whatever. You know, whatever fun thing we find. Sometimes it's just going to dinner. Coaching sessions daily. Like, I'm, if I see something, I don't wait. You know what I mean? Like, I think you can't wait for that stuff. I think we get wrapped up trying to do like a monthly get together powwow, but I think if I see a number going weird, I'll talk to them right away about that, and we'll come up with an idea to make it better, you know? All right, guys.